time to get it started now. Our next panel is the pilot controller panel. This is always a very exciting panel for all of us because pilot controller communications is the foundation of our profession. Joining me in moderating this panel is Ashley Callan from Las Vegas Tower. I would also like to welcome our panelists. So instead of introducing our panelists myself, I thought it would be better for them to introduce themselves and tell you a little bit about themselves. We'll start with Andy on the end.
Good morning, Andy Marzvari. I work at Boise Tower and Approach. I'm also the NACA Article 114 rep in the procedures office at Washington, D.C. I used to own a Piper Arrow, and I am a private pilot with an instrument rating with about 1,800 hours.
Good morning, John Drexler with the Airline Pilots Association. Some of you may recognize me from your current training videos this year. I am also a Boeing 767 captain at a Washington Dulles Airport and NACA liaison.
I'm David Iser. I'm with the Southwest Airline Pilots Association, Safety Committee Chairman, and I'm also a 737 pilot based in Atlanta.
I'm Zoe Roberts. I work at Indianapolis Center, and I'm an area NACA rep, and I'm a private pilot.
Paul Flynn. I work with NetJets, or the ExecJet call sign. I'm a pilot on the Citation 10, and I'm also on our Safety and Industry Affairs Committee.
Good morning. My name is Leah Hickling. I work at the Southern California TRACON as a controller, and I also serve on the National Recurrent Training Team.
I'm Paul Darris with the AOPA Air Safety Institute, GA pilot and flight instructor.
Thank you. So for today's panel, we will be utilizing the Twitter feed, taking questions via Twitter. So we love those. We will also take questions from the audience towards the end of the panel. So save your questions. We would like to hear from you. We have several topics today that we'll be discussing on this panel. Our first topic will be the IFR-VFR conflicts. We will also be utilizing poll questions, so get out your phones. We have a poll question for you. Our first poll question is, can you issue control instructions to VFR aircraft? Let's roll the video.
Every week, there are several IFR-VFR conflicts.
There's some misunderstandings out in the field.
Who can help us debunk these myths?
See and avoid. You think somebody is flying under those conditions and they're gonna separate themselves.
We can just ignore them because why the VFR? They're on their own.
See and avoid is an integral part of our industry, you know, but it's not the holy grail.
Pilots are responsible to see and avoid traffic. Well, two things have to happen. I've got to see the traffic first in order to be able to avoid it. It's really helpful to have another set of eyes.
Most people think that they're not allowed to vector a VFR aircraft.
You're not allowed to issue a turn or issue an altitude to a VFR aircraft.
There's some misunderstandings out in the field about what you can and can't do. Can you turn them? Can you not turn them? Can you issue an altitude? Can you issue any other sort of instructions? And the answer is yes, you can.
I'm always appreciative when somebody calls traffic for me because that's a potential threat. Most of the time, it's not going to be an issue if I need to change altitude, stop my climb, stop my descent at a certain altitude to let another airplane go by. Actually, I think that's in my own best interest.
VFR tends to fall towards the bottom of the priority list.
You can drop them down a rung.
It's in the 71-1065. When it looks at IFR and VFR, it doesn't, you know, distinguish between the two.
Doesn't say between IFR aircraft, it says between aircraft. Issue the traffic alerts, issue the safety alerts. Treat them like you would any other aircraft and help avoid those collisions, because that's what our job is.
So our poll results are very interesting. My first question is gonna go to Paul. What is the pilot expectation when it comes to VFR flight following?
When it comes to GA pilots, the difference between flight following and VFR flight following, one thing to point out is that many pilots, and I still read forums to this day, that pilots don't understand the difference between flight following and following a flight plan. They think that one can substitute for the other, and nothing can be further from the truth. So the proper way is to encourage pilots to get flight following with understanding that controllers may not be able to assist based on workload. And a flight plan, of course, we know is for search and rescue purposes if their flight does not arrive to the destination on time. So we would encourage flight following pilots to get that on the ground before they take off if they can. But the expectation from pilots really is they think sometimes one or the other, that ATC will help them assist with a flight plan type of service. Some people think it's just traffic advisory. Sometimes it's a mix.
Andy, I'd like to turn it to you now. Can you expand on VFR flight following from the perspective of a terminal controller who is also a private pilot?
Sure, and I'll start with the controller perspective. For those of us that work in Class B, C, or TIRSA airspace as controllers, we know what the answer to the question is. We do provide services to VFR aircraft very similar, if not almost exactly like an IFR aircraft. We have separation standards to meet. So those are the tools that we use to make those decisions in order to separate the traffic. From a pilot standpoint, I think pilots that normally fly in Class B, C, or TIRSA airspace have an expectation of a level of service. And once they leave those airspaces, for right or wrong, they still expect that type of service. And there's where the disconnect is, I think, between what we as controllers provide and what they get sometimes from the different facilities.
Zoe, from an en route controller's perspective, what's your obligation to VFR aircraft?
Basically, if I have time for VFR pickups, I'm going to provide a service to call traffic, weather, anything of that nature. Being a private pilot, I think I have a little more empathy, and I've always, if I'm talking to an IFR aircraft, I will vector them around them or use altitude to separate. However, if I'm not talking to the other aircraft that's a VFR, I can only do as much as I know about, so.
Leah, would you like to give us your perspective from an approach controller's from a busy approach controller on your obligation to VFR aircraft?
When working in a congested airspace, like I do, you want to speak to the VFR aircraft. It's one of the worst feelings in the world when you are vectoring a large Airbus around with a lot of passengers for a target that's just not talking to you. I give the same service to VFR aircraft that I do to IFR aircraft. I want to talk to them. I want to keep them safe. Just in the same way that I want to keep every plane safe. They're no different, and it's actually helpful to talk to them.
So Paul, how do we break the barrier and get more VFR aircraft comfortable with talking to ATC? Let's go with Paul Duress.
I think it's important that we work on educating GA pilots, not just in the cockpit, but through outreach and education that we can work together on. Years ago, AOPA Air Safety Institute collaborated with NACA to create a series of videos called Ask ATC. We had film controllers that talk about everything from flight following to IFR clearances. So the more we can educate GA pilots that how ATC operations really do operate in the real world, break down those barriers, provide education for them through various channels, I think will help a lot.
Does anybody else want to jump in on that question?
Yeah, I wanted to tag on to what Leah said. I think there's a real danger in, this is for the pilots out there, is to operate near a busy airport and think that maybe if you call ATC that you're bothering them somehow, because we'll do a much better job of controlling if we have both pieces of the equation to work with. If I don't know what you're doing, if I don't know what your altitude is really at, if I haven't verified it, I'm controlling with one hand tied behind my back. So I would prefer to talk to VFR aircraft than not talk to them.
And also to piggyback on talking about outreach and communication, we have done some wonderful things at the Southern California TRACON. Our local safety council lead, NACA lead, Rob Reddick, he started an outreach program to the local airports, and he goes out and he basically gives what I would call educational meet and greet briefings. He's gone to multiple towers. He's reached about 2,000 general aviation pilots thus far. And it's not just going out and saying, yay, I'm a controller, ask me questions. He is giving amazing information, educating GA pilots on exactly what we're talking about. We want to talk to you. Don't think that you're bothering us. You're not. And on top of that, just letting them know hotspots that they're flying through, common IFR routes, and just so that they have a better understanding of the airspace, because a lot of these GA pilots we found at the local airports, they haven't flown in a while, or they didn't realize things had changed so much. And we've seen such an amazing amount of data at the Southern California TRACON. From 2015, when Rob Reddick started the program, we are 30% down in for 2016 for TCAS resolution advisories. And we're on par for 2017 to be an additional 30% down. And our local towers have increased VFR traffic anywhere from 2 to 11% per facility. And we know that that's a direct reflection of the outreach that we've accomplished.
I'd like to add on from an air transport perspective. When we're operating large airliners in and near congested terminal areas, and we're fairly busy at that point with approaches and procedures, getting vectored around for the approach, it's very important to us that we do have a helping hand in pointing out VFR aircraft in and around our facility, because we don't have quite as much time to do the see and avoid at that point with the heads down in the cockpit sometimes.
And I'll add our two cents to this as well, that we're operating, you know, corporate jet equipment in and out of some of these regional airports along the exact same lines that Lee was referring to. We try to do our best to follow the rules and regulations, but there's a lot of times that she indicates that she has a target that she's not talking to and being lookout, and SoCal's a good one in North and New York area as well. So, you know, any way that we can emphasize that outreach to VFR aircraft to make communication something more comfortable for all of us, it's gonna help every party involved.
Thank you guys, and thank you, Leah, for sharing those statistics with us. I think that's amazing what you guys are doing there at Southern California TRACON. So we're going to move on to our next polling question. So grab your phones. When you get busy, does your speech rate increase? Roll the video.
When there's times of heavy traffic, they've just got to realize that when they're saying things quicker, like really quick, that maybe they've got to, you know, slow it down.
Obviously, it depends on your workload, but slowing down for pilots always helps. I don't think speaking louder necessarily helps. I've heard that happen before. Yeah, probably just slowing down.
If there's going to be multiple taxiways and hold positions and you can't give it to in pieces, then make sure that it's told to the pilot very slowly so they have a chance to write it down, because that's what we ask our pilots to do, is to write it down so they have those instructions and they can refer back to that if they need to.
The speed, especially certain busy centers, a GA guy coming on is not the same as a professional pilot. They're just hammering us.
So as we saw in the video, speech rate is a very common theme. And the polling results do show that as controllers, we are aware that when we get busy, our speech rate does increase. So Andy, I'd like to start with you. Is awareness of speech rate a common discussion during training?
Well, if it isn't, it should be. I once had a trainer long ago that told that during a busy session for me, of course, my speech rate started to increase because I felt like I had to. And after the session, he said, why are we talking so fast? Well, because I had a lot of airplanes. I needed to get my point across or my clearances out. He said, funny, you think you have to speak faster when you get busy because you don't have any time, but guess what? You're gonna have to find time to give the clearance twice, because more often than not, they're not gonna get it the first time when you speak fast. So that's why it should be a huge emphasis in training that standard phraseology, a normal speech rate, and using the right words in the right cadence will go a long way in pilots receiving that clearance as you intended for them to receive.
Can I add to that? I think that as far as speech rate, GA pilots in general think that controllers probably speak too fast, regardless of the busy or not. You make a strong impression on GA pilots, especially student pilots. Now, it's any chance you get to just be slow and concise with them would help. Go back to the other question you asked about breaking down barriers. That's one of the intimidation factors they have, is they feel that because controllers talk so fast, they're afraid to get in the radios and talk to them, or maybe just go around the airspace to avoid ATC altogether. So there are a lot of benefits to speaking slowly and concisely at all times, as best as possible, to help break down barriers and get pilots more involved with talking to ATC.
I'll second that, too, is that one thing's for certain is our rate of speech will increase when we're nervous or anxious, for example, in front of a few thousand audience members. But it's when there's weather, when there's congestion, when there's, you know, compression in the system, we all do it. We all start to speak quicker. And as Andy alluded to, we end up repeating ourselves and completely contradict the point altogether. So again, cadence, you know, it's nerves, all that stuff comes together in usually the worst time that it should.
You know, and I think everybody who's been on a FAM trip or a cockpit ride will attest, and our pilot friends will also attest that as much as we'd like to think they're sitting there waiting for their call sign to be called and to answer, they're not. They've got other duties in the cockpit. So controllers have the advantage. We know what we're going to say when we say it. They're not ready for the clearance, so there's a time to process that. So the faster we speak, the more likely they're going to miss it. So we need to keep our speech rate at a normal level.
There's an old story about a pilot who was flying down south, and he had sort of a slow southern accent, and the controller ripped off rapid-fire instructions, and he said, well, son, you know, you can hear the rate at which I'm speaking, and he's pretty much about the rate which I'm thinking. Now, you can say it five more times fast, or you can just say it one time real slow. Your choice.
So, yeah, it's not only the GA pilots that have issues with it, airline pilots as well. We have a lot of airports in our system, and some of these airports we don't go into very often. You go into some of these, and they have very complex taxi instructions, and you can get a very long string of lefts and rights and hold shorts. And we try to write those down, or if you get a long reroute clearance, a full route clearance, speaking a little bit slower helps us write that down. We're trying to figure out shorthand as we write it down and remember it.
So, Zoe, could you elaborate on things that pilots could do to aid you as the controller and lessen your workload when you're busy? So, can you elaborate on things that pilots can do to help you when you're busy, like correct readbacks and things like that?
So what pilots can do is basically read back correctly, or, you know, and if you don't understand, say you don't understand, because I'd rather have you say that and then I miss a readback because you guessed and I, you know, have four other things going on behind me and, you know, I missed it. So I'd rather have you question and verify.
Yeah, and just to piggyback on that, our phraseology is clear and concise when we use it properly. And I think that as controllers, if we practice that, we can also expect the pilots to practice that clear and concise readbacks of what we're saying. And it would go a long way to help us out, I think, on both ends of communication spectrum.
If I may, you know, just a simple ILS clearance. So we've all been taught position, heading, altitude, clearance. If you give it in that order, and they read it back in that order, there's the checks and balances for ATC to make sure the readback is correct. Now, if you give it in that order and the pilot chooses to read it back mixed up but gets all the elements in there, it takes time for our brains to process that to make sure that all the elements were correct. That's the importance of standard phraseology.
So I'm going to direct a question to John. Are you able to anticipate when a controller might speak quicker? And is there anything you can do in the flight deck to catch the clearance the first time?
Sure. I mean, I think back to my days when I was a LaGuardia controller, and I had a lot of work on my plate. We're doing a push, and I'm in a hurry to get through all that work, so I'll spit it out pretty rapid fire, and it's automatic to me. I may not even hear what I'm saying, but I've said it 10,000 times, so it just flows. However, that may not be true of who's listening on the other end of the frequency. So if someone's busy, obviously, I know they're going to speak quicker. But one of the things I'm going to do is, if I know I listen ahead and see what you're giving the aircraft in front of me. This comes in especially handy to me when I'm operating overseas and I'm dealing with accents that aren't quite so easy in my ear, especially heading down toward San Paolo. So I have to listen up on the frequency, see what they're giving traffic in front of me, and anticipate that. And that goes a long way in that respect.
So for Leah or Zoe, what are some common practices you yourself use or train when workload permits an increased speech rate? What are some best practices that you use?
I know when I train new controllers that think that speaking fast is what we're supposed to be doing because we have a lot to do, I kind of go back to a high school drama class where they told us to talk to us like we were not very smart, you know, and it actually has worked quite a bit, and, you know, eventually that just becomes a normal rate that's somewhere in between. So that's kind of what I teach a little bit, but.
Yeah, I think also when you're training new controllers, the first thing that they want to do when you tell them you need to work faster is increase their speech rate. And so you really need to differentiate to them what you mean by work faster. I mean, I want you to type while you talk, and I want you to look at all 20 aircraft on your scope at the same exact time. But I do not want you to speak faster because nobody will understand you. I know it happens all the time to me.
So Paul Flynn, as a pilot, are you aware of the controller's workload based on their speech rate? And what ways can you help lessen that?
I would say that, yes, you are aware of the workload because we have the same behavior. Andy alluded to the fact that you know the clearance is coming before we get it. And when the high workload environment, high speech rates come into play, it is hard, or it's easier to miss your call sign, especially our tail number is QS, every single one of them. So we have one differentiating digit to whether it was me or somebody else. And that happens a lot coming into New York, a lot going to Southern Florida, and of course California, as you've alluded to, is just this traffic everywhere. So we are aware of it, and we try to be sympathetic to it. And what comes to mind for me is arriving into New York on the Jake or the Wilkes-Barre. You know, we come down, we're just in Newark's airspace, and we're in the mix of GA aircraft, and you just wait to check on. The controller knows you're there, but you're just adding to the pile of anxiety and speech rate, and it gets quick. So yes, we're very much aware of that workload. We'd love to know how we can help, but it's evident.
And from the GA perspective?
From the GA perspective? Certainly. I mean, like I said a little bit earlier, we operate in out of airports all over the country. We are cleared for a lot more visual approaches than we would when I was at 121 environment. So we're interacting also on like unicoms, where we show up and somebody's Sunday afternoon is now trying to deal with jet traffic in the pattern. So it's not just in an ATC perspective, it's also in a VFR world where separation is just dependent upon us, or we just came out of a terminal environment and you guys are still in one ear because we haven't canceled and we're trying to coordinate that too. So, and I can think, I'm using SoCal as a great example because you guys know there's just so many airplanes, so many airports, and operations are just, especially I'm thinking Sunday afternoons. So yeah, there's a lot to juggle. In any way that the outreach I keep alluding back to is a great, great tool with which to pivot off of and see about working on that standard phraseology And we do. We repeat what you guys say. If you guys give us a standard rebound or standard clearance, we will repeat. That's generally what we're taught to do, read back the clearance. We don't do it perfectly every time, but we try.
I'd like to just tag on to the point you made about similar sounding call signs. It's something I've been seeing a lot, especially with all the new congestion in the national airspace system. We're listening up for a lot of times our company and for our numerical call number. And sometimes we get one or the other, but they sound similar, and you may start getting aircraft, picking up other aircraft's clearances. Very important if you start seeing that happen, remember to repeat, you know, United, you know, 173, United, repeating that company name again behind the numeric number. Or even if you just hear the numbers are similar, make sure that, you know, you listen for the read back, hear back on that, because next thing you know, the guy you're talking to already left your frequency, went to somebody else, and that makes for a whole new can of worms.
So that kind of leads into our next section, which is standardization. So get out your phones again. Our next question is, in which instance are you more likely to shortcut a clearance? Go ahead and roll the video.
I have seen inconsistencies from different controllers in different parts of the United States. For instance, flying in different parts of Texas compared to flying in the Northeast, where it's busier airspace. There's some inconsistencies.
Stick to standard phraseology, because there are some phraseology like proceed on course is sneaking in there where it's not standard, probably not in the 7110, but it's becoming normalized just through frequent use. And 90% of the time it works fine because the pilot more or less understands what it means, but when they're trying to learn the system and there's no standard guidance on it, it's impossible to tell them what it means.
I think one of the items as a controller you can do is, remember, you know the area real well, but the areas that we go into, it may be our first time there. And if we're a little unsure, rather than getting a little bit short and curt with us, give us a little bit of an advisory, and we're more than happy to do what you want. It's just that we don't know what you want.
It's really hard to teach a student, you know, these are the steps and the procedures that, you know, when we talk to ATC, when ATC isn't following those steps or procedures, because they're just summing it up because we're at our hometown airport.
We're in an airport, it may be one of the hubs, one of the major airports around the country, but we may have not been there for quite a while. Even though it's an exec check call sign, it doesn't mean that we've been there. It doesn't mean that we are real familiar with the local area. So it'd be nice if ATC on occasion would, you know, slow down and allow us to kind of take in what they're saying.
I think if we get ATC to consistently do everything the same way and don't shorten it up, I think that would help out in the long term.
So the poll results are interesting. The 45% familiar pilots and 43% when you are busy. So David, can you expand on the importance of consistency when it comes to control instructions?
Yeah, so noticing that with familiar pilots, again, going back to, we have about 8,000 pilots at Southwest, and we fly all around the country. And you may work a Southwest flight consistently, but today you may have a Southwest pilot that's never been into your airport. And if there's two of them, then giving them some of the local slang, if you will, can confuse them, or they may not understand what you're trying to say. A good example of consistency and how it breeds expectation from pilots is flying out of Las Vegas here. It was one of our first airports that had a hold down on the departure. You'd be cleared to a higher altitude, but you'd have to hold down to a fix. And when oftentimes we'd be cleared above that fix by the TRACON, they would remove that restriction, and they would say climb unrestricted, just to clear up any confusion. If they failed to say climb unrestricted, the pilot would ask if it was an unrestricted climb. Of course, now we know, you know, through the climb via trials, that climb and maintain means climb unrestricted. When pilots tried to get controllers to say that at other airports, controllers were hesitant to say that. That's a non-standard phraseology. So this was a case where the non-standard phraseology clarified the clearance, but it actually caused confusion at another center. So consistency across the system. It's getting better. It's getting much better.
Paul, would you like to speak to this? Paul Flynn?
He's alluded to the fundamentals of it all is that we might not see an airport for months, if not a year, even though you've seen the call sign every day, all day. My coworker just alluded to that. We do. We have almost, 3,000 pilots. We fly all over the world, and we fly to airports that we need to look up. So sometimes we'll go through periods of time, like I've been in and out of Seattle a lot lately, but then I'll go 6 or 7 months and I won't see the place at all, and I'll be back into, the Houston airspace or, just back and forth between Florida and New York. And understanding that is greatly appreciated. He alluded to the standard phraseology. We're all struggling right now with climb via, descend via. That's been a hot topic for a long time. I'll never forget Vegas was that one. It was either the trailer departure or one of those where you're climbing 190, but there's a stop at 7,000. And we depart off 19 a lot at ExitJet, and sure enough, they just say, you're clear for takeoff 19 left, climb 7,000, because they knew we'd probably blow it. So we're all working on that, and the collaboration will be pivotal for that. And David, he pretty much summed that up, so I'll leave it for that, but yes.
And I'll ask this for all the pilots. Do you have any training programs that help with standardization across, but like talk about that amongst yourselves and in your companies?
Yeah, I'll speak to that first with GA pilots and for all pilots, really. AOPA Air Safety Institute has an online course called Say It Right, Mastering Radio Communication. And we walk pilots through the standard phraseology in the real world to understand how and when to use it appropriately. But we also offer videos and all different kinds of material to help pilots understand standard phraseology.
At the airlines, I think all the airlines now have gone to AQP, an advanced qualification program, to where instead of just coming in for a check ride once a year or twice a year, you come in and it's more of a recurrent training. And as part of that, you do a line-oriented evaluation where you're simulating an actual flight within the system. When Climb Via first came out, we included that in the line-oriented, in that flight. And so you had to use the proper phraseology in a controlled environment, and if you didn't, it was a debrief item. It was something you could discuss with the instructor afterwards, and we noticed a large improvement in compliance and understanding after that. So there is a continuous training process. Sometimes it takes a while to get everybody through.
No, I think for controllers, it's we can use the analogy of a golfer. A good golfer develops muscle memory in his swing, to where it's the same time every time. And I don't think we're much different with our brains. If we develop standard phraseology and practice it all the time, it's there each and every time. When we get busy, instead of speaking at a faster rate, we fall back on a standard phraseology.
Yeah, you fall to your training, not rise to the occasion.
I'll tag on to what you were saying earlier about the climb via, descend via phraseology. In a different context, you've all heard the phrase, words matter, and they especially matter within our profession. I've looked at CISP reports where pilots have been given climb via clearances, except maintain or descend via, and sometimes, especially when the procedures are new, they went ahead and just dialed in the top altitude and climbed right to it. Because they somehow in their minds, especially with the new procedure they weren't 100% familiar with yet, thought the accept erased all the restrictions along the route of the flight, that initial procedure. So it's very important that when the pilot repeats the clearance, that he repeats it exactly the way you issued it. And if you don't hear that, make them do it again, just so they understand. It'll save you a lot of heartache and save them a lot of heartache.
I'll give this brief. I know we're trying to stay on time, but one thing from our perspective, David alerted to it, we do train for this stuff. We simulate the climb via, descend via, but we're also learning how to use the automation in our aircraft for this. So we can be fully configured, and when we get a turn off and then a return to the departure and resume, sometimes that muscle memory that Andy refers to, we're working on. And I'm hopefully going to do a lot better in my cockpit than I ever will at my golf game, but it's part of it. And when you give us those clearances, not only are we trying to comply with the law and what your expectations of what the aircraft's going to do, but we're trying to get better at understanding how to tell the airplane to do it. And our automation and every airplane across has a little bit different way of doing it. So keep that in mind too. We're working on it and we're open to the feedback that can work its way into our AQP program, as David alluded to.
Leah, Could you talk, we've talked about how important it is for controllers to use proper and standard consistent phraseology. Could you talk about how important it is for pilots to do the same, to read things back correctly and completely?
Yeah, I mean, I think we've already touched on it, but it's just as important for pilots to be clear, concise, read things back exactly the way we say it. I don't know how many times I've been busy, I read the complete clearance, and they read back almost the complete clearance. And in my head, I've said, I'm sure they got it. But the one thing they missed is the one thing they messed up, and I didn't get that. So as much as possible, pilots need to read back stuff, just like we need to reiterate our phraseology, especially when it's new phraseology. Once again, SoCal, we just had our OAPA Metroplex procedures come in. A lot of us are not used to climb via, descend via, accept, maintain. And from a training perspective, because I am a trainer, every class that I ran, I said, if you do nothing else, please, please, please practice the phraseology today. Let me practice it with you over and over and over again. We have to get it right so that the pilots can get it right.
If I could add to that, to Leah's comment, is don't be afraid to hold pilots accountable. If there's something they're not reading back correctly or missing part of the clearance, do what she said and just have them read back part of the clearance they missed. That's a teachable moment for you to make an impression on GA pilots and they can learn better going forward.
Wonderful, thank you, you guys. All right, grab your phones. We have another polling question for you. What are some cues that a pilot may be unsure or require extra assistance when it comes to ground operations? Roll the video.
Probably the most help is realizing, particularly on departure when we're taxiing out, if they're going to change runways or change departure procedure, that we have to make changes in the cockpit takes a lot of time.
There's local knowledge or an accepted practice moving around an airport that a controller may assume that because you're there, you just know it.
And you have, for example, three or four different taxiways, that, and especially the ones that involve multiple letter names of taxiways, those become a little bit more difficult to record properly when you're trying to write them down, to retain them, especially when they're crossing other runways or hotspots.
Or just recognizing that if you're going to give us a lot of changes and then want us to take off immediately, that's probably not going to be a realistic expectation.
And then in some cases, some airports are allowed to give multiple runway crossing instructions at one time. But at the same time, most pilots now are used to only one runway crossing at one time. Now that I know that it should only be one at a time in most cases, if I get a multiple crossing, I'll query and say, is that really okay? Because I'm not sure what your local rule is.
I've been given taxi clearances that when we got to the crossing runway, we had not been given clearance of that. It was taxi to runway 34, and we had a crossing runway to get through. So we stopped and asked for it.
So I think the polling results are very good to touch on. As we can see, the tone of voice says a lot. We know that sometimes nonverbal communication can convey more than what you're actually saying. And as controllers, all we have is the tone of voice, and we can go off what we hear through our headset over the radio. So I'd like Andy to touch on what are some cues you listen for when aircraft are taxiing, and what makes you feel that they understood the clearance as it relates to tone of voice.
Well, I think a questioning tone of voice is the first thing you would listen for. Someone who may or may not be familiar with the airport, we all assume that every pilot flies with a current chart and is actually looking at it when they're on the surface of the airport. I work at a fairly easy airport layout, and it's amazing how many people get lost on a parallel taxiway. I don't get it, but that's a bad assumption for us. They're supposed to fly with a chart that's current, and they're supposed to use the chart. But if they read back a clearance with a question on the end, or they're slow to read it back, or if they don't read it back at all, to me, that might be a cue that they're scrambling trying to find out where they need to go. Don't be afraid to offer progressive taxi instructions at that point. We don't have to wait for them to ask for that. We can provide that information. Some things I look out the window, if I see somebody taxiing at an incredibly slow pace, there might be something that I can do to help that out. It's obvious that maybe they don't know where they're going. Help them out. Offer that progressive taxi. If they make the wrong turn right off the get-go, I mean, there's your answer right there. But there's certain cues we can certainly see out the window. And it's our job to provide the instructions when they need it.
One of the things I was first taught when I started in the business was never release your brake until you know where you're going to go and what you're going to do. Never press a mic button unless you know what you're going to say. Nothing worse than just dead air and along on the frequency. Which I just did. So in any case, you'll see a hesitation. The aircraft, A, may not respond to your control instruction right away because their pilots are looking at each other and going, do you understand what that guy said or what we're supposed to do? Or may taxi slowly. One of the things, though, at least in the air transport cockpits now, we have our iPads, we have Jeppesons that are updated before every flight, so we'll always have a current chart, at least from our perspective, and they've added a little highlighter where you can actually highlight your route to the gate, just make sure you're running your finger along the right route. So we do have some additional tools available to us now that we didn't have in the past through technology, but in the end, please, please look out the window and make sure they're doing what you want them to do. I have done accident investigations in the past where it was sort of a set it and forget it type mindset, you know, clear for takeoff and never look to see if the guy A, started the takeoff roll, B, if he got airborne, didn't go off the edge of the runway, or turned in the right direction after departure, after he disappeared into an overcast and actually went the wrong way. That made for some excitement in TCAS. So real critical. It's not the pilots. Make sure they, A, repeated the correct clearance, and B, complied.
I'll put the GA spin on that from our perspective. We don't necessarily park at the gates. We park at an FBO on the field, which is not always in your repetitive pattern. And we talk about what are the cues. One of my favorites is normally that, okay, whiskey, kilo, fox, crit across, 2-2 right, hold short, 2-2 left. You know, when we talk, and I'm trying to type into a scratch pad, and I type out as well on FMS as I do on a keyboard. We do our best to admit we want a progressive, but for some reason there's that little bit of, I can do this, I'm a professional, please pick up on the cues and just tell us to stop. And as John just alluded to, we really shouldn't be moving the airplane until we know we're going anyway. And that highlighting ticket, and if you're allowed to use your known position on your iPad now, tremendous help. So the technology is definitely creeping in, and now on an iPad you can take it into any cockpit on any airplane. So
I wanted to ask, you talked a little bit about flying into airports that you haven't been into before after maybe 6 months of not flying into the airport. What do you do to prepare for those kind of flights? We'll start with Paul Flynn.
All right, I'll lead that one. We know that we fly into airports, and just last night at dinner, we were discussing some of this stuff regarding the panel. It's not uncommon where I will get a brief update on my iPhone and literally not know where that airport is. I will have to go look it up. And you'll be en route, and this is my anecdotal story. We're flying from somewhere in Texas to Hawthorne, Nevada. And on the way, Oakland says, ExecJet, are you guys landing Hawthorne? There's a momentary panic in the cockpit, of course, because we're like, yes. Because she's like, well, great. I'm like, we think so. And eventually, it became that point where even a few other aircraft on the frequency were curious, like, well, where is that? And that leads into preparing for it. You know, we had looked it up. We made sure our first fear was like, what NOTAM did we miss? Is the airport even open? But yeah, we do. We prepare for it. We look at, is it controlled? Is it uncontrolled? Is it mountainous terrain? Is it underlying airspace? You know, what kind of traffic can we expect there? Hawthorne, Nevada, not a major concern, I promise. But that's what it comes down to, is NOTAMs. Is it controlled? Isn't it? Is it underlying airspace? Atlanta's a big issue for that, you know, because your floor, your class B is pretty high. We're landing like Peachtree. Where are we going to taxi to? You know, what is the condition of the runways? And that can be applied to any airport, but more importantly, those that when you've never been to one, or you've never been to one outside of the country, it gets even more interesting, and we do a lot of that too. So it's the same rule of thumb we've learned from the very beginning. It's just making sure that you stick to those rules that you learned so long ago.
If I could add two things to that, something that we like to teach GA pilots, in addition to NOTAMs and all the pre-flight stuff that Paul had covered, was to look at the airport diagram before we even depart from our departure airport and think through all the possible scenarios you may be able to, you may have to walk through. Are the NOTAMs that have certain taxiways, runways closed for construction, for example? And then on route, before you pick up approach control, is just listen on the frequency and find out what are our pilots getting. Of course, airlines may be getting a different runway, but maybe getting the shorter GA runway, and that's fine. But listen in, get a good situational awareness of what's going on, and prepare yourself for all the possible scenarios that might be offered by ATC.
So at the airlines, we don't fly to as many odd airports. We pretty much know ahead of time where we're going to go. And so at Southwest, we've developed station information pages, which has information unique to that airport. And it will include not only our company frequency, where we park, de-icing procedures. It'll let us know if we're supposed to call for a pushback clearance or if we just push back on our own. It also includes some of the other idiosyncrasies of each airport. What do the controllers expect? We try to gather that information before our first flight goes there in order to educate the pilots on what's going on so they have a source of information on what to expect and have a little bit of information. It's not always perfect, but we also include in that, we'll include ASAP reports, if there's anything from our Aviation Safety Action Program, similar to ATSAP. We do communicate between ASAP, collaborate between ASAP and ATSAP. And we'll also have the NASA ASRS reports in there if it's an airport. We don't have any of those reports, just so we know what mistakes other guys made going in there. And it helps us prepare, but it's not always everything you need to know.
One of the things that we do at my airline, especially, we will actually, during our pre-flight brief, while we're sitting in the cockpit, we'll start right at the gate and talk about, we're pushing back from this gate, we can expect these procedures, we'll be coming out along this line, we may get this particular taxi route, we may have some hot spots along the way, so we need to be extra vigilant as we get clearance to cross these runways or proceed through these hot spots, right up through the type of departure we're flying and what restrictions are on it. So we go through sort of a dry run before we even release the brake.
See, that's actually kind of comforting as a controller to know that. Some of this information I did not know. I wanted to ask Zoe, being a center controller, I know that when I have foreign air carriers come through my airspace, I tend to take a little more care in my control instructions. Can you elaborate a little bit more on that?
Well, I know a few people will choose to vector the opposite aircraft because they know they'll get a correct read back if it's a non-foreign. Unfortunately, that's just true. However, when I do have to give routing or controls instruction, I definitely speak more clearly. I spell things out phonetically because I know for a fact that they're not from here. So that's what I try to do.
Leah?
Yeah, just to speak, when you're speaking to foreign airline pilots, it can be difficult. You, once again, have to be clear and concise. You have to speak slowly. And sometimes you have to ask them to read things back slower. I have not understood, especially in the GA environment, when you have student pilots that are foreign language pilots, they speak very quickly. I have asked a pilot to read me back his call sign 8 times. Slower, please. Just the last 2 now. And it is a reflection on all of us, controllers, pilots, GA, professional, foreign pilots. We all need to be clear, concise. We need to practice it all day, every day. I saw a Twitter comment. Someone had said that they've seen where their speech rate has increased. The pilots hear it. They increase their speech rate, and it's a very efficient session. And I wonder if it was 100% speech rate increase, or if it was also the fact that the controller was clear and concise, stopped saying all the good days, everything was 100% standard, the speech rate might have increased, but I bet you that clear and concise phraseology was what also made that session so streamlined.
That's a good point.
Absolutely. So I'd like to ask this question to all of our pilots. Can you explain what is happening on the flight deck when you're taxiing out for departure versus taxiing to the gate on arrival, and the differences in workload?
So before we even leave the gate, we try to prepare for the flight. So we'll brief and discuss everything that has to do with that flight from the moment we push back to we're off the SID, and we're in the en route portion. And so we try to get everything done before we actually start moving the aircraft, to include trying to predict what our taxi route's going to be. At some airports, that's fairly easy, especially if you're familiar with them. If it's an unfamiliar airport, or some airports will give you something that you're just not expecting. So that increases your workload a little bit. But generally on the taxi out, we try to get everything done at the gate so we can focus on the taxi out. Now, if we get a runway change or the weather changes significantly and we have to redo our performance numbers, that involves some programming of the FMS and a checklist. If you change our runway, that could change our departure, and that's going to cause us to have to brief all those points again and reconfirm all our crossing restrictions, speeds and altitudes along that route that's in our flight management system, in order to make sure we're both on the same page, so everybody's on the same page on what we're going to do. Landing can be a little bit more difficult depending on the airport. You generally know what gate you're going to go to, but some airports you don't. Some airports, they won't give you a gate until after you land. And so you're touching down, reconfiguring the aircraft from flying to landing, pulling off the runway, transitioning to a taxi, tower's handing you off to ground. Ground wants to know what gate you're going to, but you're trying to call your company and find out what gate you're going to. Some airports, the ground controller will ask you if you're cleared into the ramp yet, so now you got to call the ramp control. So it can get pretty busy right there in that transition as you're exiting the runway. Atlanta used to be a very easy airport. You either turned right or left. Now with 2-8, they could give you a unexpected standard taxi clearance, which causes you to flip through multiple pages to find that standard taxi, and then you got to go back to your 10-9 page and look at the airport diagram to look at that. At the same time, you could talk to 5 controllers from the time you land to the time you get to your gate. So it can get a little bit more complex on the taxi and generally than the taxi out. The taxi out, you're only getting, it only gets difficult if there's a big change in your in the plan.
I'll start at the end. The taxi in is awesome. I might be able to get up and feel my legs again. The person I've been sitting next to for the past 5 to 6 or 7 hours is free of me, and the focus is on a decent cup of coffee. That said, I use that joke is that you're starting to check out, and that's when we need to focus a lot. We're wrapping up the flight mentally, but we still have to get that plane to its parking location, and we need to plan that way just as much as we do from pushing back, planning our taxi route out, working with ATC, knowing the departure, with the whole flight ahead of us, and that mental position to do so. We brief the approach, and I'd say that more often than not, you plan on which way you're going to turn off the runway, and your briefing stops there. And you do, and you start to think about packing your bag up and getting on with the day, or planning the next leg, or you know, where you're going to fit a meal in. So I would say in this whole example, we've discussed about the pushback and the taxi out and planning taxis. It's that taxi in where our biggest risk is we're already moving on to the next segment or what we're doing next. And our briefings, for me, I know I need to focus on. They stop. I'm like, we're going to clear it to the right, you know, work with ATC and find our parking location. And I would probably put that in my areas that I need to improve the most. So hopefully that clarifies a little bit of our position on that.
And then, Paul, from a VFR aircraft aspect, can you kind of give us your opinion on that and how we can help you?
Yeah, a lot of the same things these guys already mentioned as far as GA pilots preparing to head out. Preparing for the departure, doing the pre-takeoff briefing with each other in the cockpit. There's one pilot doing it to himself. clarifying with controllers any kind of routing that he or she may be uncertain about, especially unfamiliar airport. And pilots should not hesitate to speak up and let controllers know, I'm unfamiliar, can I get a progressive? That's a training thing that we're addressing. As far as the inbound traffic coming in, again, we encourage pilots to be well prepared, be familiar with the airport layout and possible taxi options to your FBO or to your ramp. But really, you guys do a great job as far as the controllers helping GA pilots in and out of the airports. It's really the burden is on GA pilots to be better prepared for both phases of flight.
Okay, so I'm just going to ask one more question, and then we'll go to audience questions. We do have two people out in the audience, if you can flag them down if you have any questions for us. But I wanted to ask Andy, as controllers, what can we do to be more aware when it comes to ground movement?
I think one of the most important things for tower controllers, at least, are to know where their hotspots, their published hotspots are in the airport, and try to understand why they are published as hotspots. It's real easy for us to sit in the tower cab at 250 or 300 feet and look down on an airport and say, I don't see what the problem is. It looks perfectly normal and logical. But put yourself in the place of an aircraft 2 or 3, 4 feet above the ground for some of the smaller GAs and probably no more than 15 feet. Things look a lot different. During the day, they look different. During night, they look completely out of whack. And with lights and rain and snow, that's where the problem comes in. So when you're operating under those conditions, if you're operating in a rainstorm or at night, keep that in mind and be cognizant of those airplanes as they approach those hot spots to double check that something doesn't go wrong there. Because if it's going to go wrong, it's most likely to go wrong at the hot spot, because that's why it's a hot spot to begin with.
Thank you. Anybody else want to add anything?
I'll tag on to that, and you raised a good point. One of the things that I see a lot are runway departure ends that are co-located. You can have two diverging runways have the same starting point. It can be especially confusing for pilots, and we need to be extra vigilant about that, and I make sure everybody agrees. You know, one of the things we have to do is we have to verify the runway and the taxiway just prior to taking it to make sure we're getting on at the right point for the right runway. So obviously that's a very critical item. So that's one of the things that hotspots are real critical for. And again, make sure the pilot is turning on to the right runway if they're both co-located points.
Right.
If I could add that real quick. I think we all know that runway incursions are a big problem for general aviation pilots. That's been one of the topics coming up today, as a matter of fact, one of the sessions. But I think that if we could just get GA pilots to stop hold of the hold short line when they're told to do so, that would cut incursions literally in half. So if you sense a pilot's kind of approaching that runway area kind of quickly, or you're not sure if he or she really understood the clearance, don't hesitate to, maybe that's a part when you get really slow with our communications, is reminding GA pilots, hold short at the hold short line. That would help us a little bit.
We're going to go out to the audience. Do you have any questions?
Hey, Don. I do have one. It says, in the in-route airspace, does a VFR pilot receiving flight following have to comply with control instructions? I think it's more directed towards Andy.
I didn't hear the first part of the question.
In the in-route airspace, does a VFR pilot receiving flight following have to comply with control instructions?
I think the FARs do say that they do have to comply with the control instructions if they're receiving service from ATC. If they don't want to, they can elect not to receive the services any longer. I mean, we're not normally going to issue instructions just for practice. We're doing it for a reason. But if they don't want to comply, they can terminate their service.
Go ahead. She's walking around out there.
I have one over here, Don.
Okay. Carrie.
Am I going?
Go ahead.
Are SID and STAR charts becoming so complex that by default they lead to non-standard phraseology to clarify?
Ready to go?
Yes.
What can we do to help alleviate that? From the controller's perspective?
I think going back to the collaboration piece. When we're designing the SIDS and the STARS, you need to have pilots and controllers involved in that, and kind of run through how that's going to look like when it hits the paper. We've had STARS that have gotten so complicated, we just don't do them. So we'll request a different STAR, and if we're given that STAR, we'll simply say unable. And we're working through that with those agencies to make sure that's repaired. But a lot of times on the STARS, you know, now that we have the iPads, we can expand it. We can do the pinch zoom. We can expand it. There'll be a little ball note, but it'll be way over on the other side. It's easy to miss one of those. Just in the design of the chart, putting what you need to know at that fix and not a note about a speed restriction somewhere off to the side would help. Of course, pilots looking at the entire chart as well. But there's also information on there that you scan over because there's a lot of extra information. But if you see us starting to do something and it doesn't look right, you guys see airplanes flying these arrivals and these departures every day. You kind of know when one's a little bit out of sequence. And if you mention something to them, hey, just want to make sure you're going to do this. Don't say what altitude are you at. Or don't say where are you going? Because nothing scares us more than that. But just kind of remind us, hey, I just want to make sure you got that restriction ahead. You guys are going to level off, right?
And with reference to the same subject, just keep in mind, if we're flying a procedure that's been pre-programmed for a flight management computer, we've briefed it at length, and we're flying this down, when we get pulled off for either a vector or speed adjustment or any change to what we programmed and briefed, it requires us to get back in the box, to make the changes that are appropriate, to rebrief, make sure everybody's on the same page and will comply. And then if it was a vector and they were re-cleared to a point further along on the procedure, make sure you indicate whether or not we're to resume the entire procedure once we get to that point. Because without that, it becomes a lateral procedure only, not necessarily the vertical component may be lost in that discussion. Also, the computer has to recalculate that data from that point, as where earlier it was looking at a point behind us or abeam us, so that will affect our descent from there. So we have to make sure the phraseology is very clear. You're re-cleared to rejoin the procedure from this point.
I just wanted to add one more thing to that point about the charts. At headquarters in the procedures office, this is a huge topic with descend via and how complex some of these procedures are becoming and the available real estate on a chart to put these procedures. And so I do believe that anything within the four corners of that chart that pilot should be familiar with, but how much do we put within the four corners of that chart, and how complex can we make a procedure without running the risk of confusion and errors after we do so? So that needs to be looked at, I believe.
Our next question.
I just wanted to know, with all the changes to phraseology that we have as controllers, when changes to the .65 are made, how do the pilots get that information? Because, for example, with the change to how you use the departure clearance void times, where they changed it from the actual time to, oh, you're released in 5 minutes or 10 minutes or whatever. Like, how are we creating a mutual understanding between the controllers and the pilots to be able to use standard phraseology if there's no formal training on the pilot side?
I could answer that one there. Thank you for the great question. I think it comes down to a lot of education and outreach. That's one of the areas at AOPA we're working closely with NACA to be aware of changes coming down the pike or coming soon would help us create press releases or news articles or educational videos material to help GA pilots know, here are changes coming about at this date, be familiar with it, and we'll even create some scenarios to help pilots walk through that to understand how those phraseology changes would impact them. Good question.
Brandon.
Hello, my name is Guy Chetta from Philly Tracon. Thank you for your time. This year's recurrent training had some conflicting information about TCAS-2 resolution advisories. The 0.65 says, do not issue control instructions that are contrary to the RA. Since TCAS-2 RAs only issue instructions on the vertical plane, can I and should I still issue vectors to aircraft to provide positive separation while pilots are responding to an RA?
One of the things we have to do when we respond to a resolution alert is to follow the direction that's on our ADI. So we can deviate from that. A little red bar will come up in the case of my aircraft, and we have to make sure we don't go into the red. So we don't really have much room to deviate from there. Once it says that the conflict is ended, then at that point we can comply with any instructions you might have. But it's this system, the software is set up to avoid the collision. We have to follow it to a T.
You do bring up a really good point in the fact that it's vertical versus lateral. When we receive a resolution advisory, my only communication to you is TCAS RA, and I'm correcting. You can give me a lateral correction, but that's a great thing as to whether or not that's crystal clear between both parties, because it's looking at time to collision. That's all TCAS does, and it only does on that vertical scope. So as far as we're trained, I will tell you two things, TCAS RA, and then returning to previous clearance. And that's a really good point. I mean, that's talking about traffic separation at its purest, so maybe sometime by the end of this, we'll have an idea, and someone could put that out for a crystal clear way of making it even better.
You know, and I understand why you would want to do that, because our main job is to prevent a collision between the aircraft, but I think if a TCAS resolution alert says climb, 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 and you pull back, and now I issue you a turn, we could be inadvertently putting the airplane in a flight configuration that is not acceptable. So I think we need to back off, let the pilots do what the aircraft is telling them to do, and issue traffic and safety alerts as required.
And the reason for the question was we're trying to prevent a domino effect, where in Philly, you have guys above you at 500 feet. So if one goes up, the other one's going to go up, and the other one's going to go up. So if I turn you, I kind of could prevent everybody from having a domino effect. That was the reason for the question.
Sorry, just to speak from a recurrent training standpoint, I believe where that information came from was the idea of you just had a TCAS RA, but there is traffic in a close proximity that the aircraft is not actually TCASing on, but if they start that descent, it now becomes a double, almost emergency type of situation. And what we said was, in general, if you absolutely had to, you could also try to turn the aircraft out of the way. I don't think it was meant to say any TCAS, just give them a turn, but rather to resolve an additional dangerous situation that might occur.
Thank you. Next question.
Rob Reddick, SoCal Tracon, LSC lead. Three things. There's a couple questions on the board from Twitter. Is Operation Rain Check up and running? At SoCal Tracon it is, and it's a huge success. We can't get people in there fast enough, so I think it's up to your facility. The other thing was about English-speaking pilots and how do you report them. If you're not aware, there is a drop-down MOR now for the Aviation English Language Proficiency to report these pilots so FISDO can get involved, and we've seen success there at SoCal Tracon also with that, with the FISDO. But my question is to the OPA rep up there. I really feel like the VFR pilots specifically are kind of set up for failure with their qualifications to get a VFR pilot's license. We're seeing them get the education to get out of their class Delta. Life is good, they can land, they can do touch and goes, but they get out of their class Delta, they go 1200, they make a right-hand turn, and they cross the final approach course at the final approach altitude, causing significant safety issues, especially at SoCal Tracon. Is there any education for VFR pilots to teach them, maybe not necessarily how to fly an IFR approach, but to avoid these areas, especially in complex areas like SoCal Tracon, where you know we're at 1.6 million operations in the terminal district there in Southern California already through the first 6 months of the physical year. What are we doing together with AOPA to educate these pilots to stay away from these very significant areas and to keep not only themselves, but the other aircraft and coming down safe?
Yeah, I think that's an interesting scenario. That's a good opportunity for us to work close with NACA to target particular airports and airspaces that have those kind of issues occurring. So if that's an area where you're experiencing or seeing that, we should discuss that at some point as far as addressing some training needs for the area. As far as the general GA pilot audience, we can certainly train to that as well. But I think at this point, it would be a good opportunity to look at any kind of areas that you're seeing in your airspaces and airports where there are problems. We can help target those areas to address GA pilots in particular.
Brandon.
Hi, my name is Nate Johns, Albuquerque Center safety rep. I really appreciate your guys' discussion about standardization of phraseology. One thing I noted that we've been chided on by our ECVs, we see it regularly in our QC checks, is once again dropped call signs. And I think it's a critical safety issue just as much as hearback readback, but I'd like to propose in the same vein that NACA has, you know, fully charged, turn off, tune in, that we have an outreach between NACA, the FAA, all the airlines and GA groups, a program called Call Sign Every Time. I would rather hear the call sign and ensure that we have positive communication over the shortened readbacks, because we at least need to know we're talking to the right pilot. I'd love some feedback from the panel on that.
This came up last year on the use of a full call sign. If we're not using our full call sign, get on our case. You know, shame us on the frequency, whatever it takes, because we're not doing it. You know, don't be afraid to say, I'm sorry, who was that? 921 what? I mean, keep patient, because there's one thing that will leave a mark on you is that's how you remember. It's like, I got to get back into this. I got to be more professional. So don't be afraid to speak up, you know, because we'll abbreviate or just give you the last few numbers or whatever the case might be. And this was a big topic last year, too, so it's a great idea.
Yep. Carrie?
Good morning. Anne Marie Taggio, Potomac Tracon. This question is specifically about a descend via clearance that's happened to me several times. Most pilots, when I give them a speed restriction, I'll say at 16,000, reduce speed to 210. But I've had a few that will do that, but level off at 16,000. Is there something I'm saying that, and not continue on with the descend via clearance? Do I need to say something after that? Or sometimes they use a fix at this fix, reduce speed to 210, and then they'll continue to descend via, but there are several that stop at that altitude.
That could be a programming thing where you say, when we're passing 16, we'll enter that speed, that slow to 160, and the airplane's only way to do that is to pitch up. Like, we're already idle, you know, slowing a plane down into descent, sometimes you can have one, but you can't have both. And I think John will allude to this too.
Not to cut you off, but first time that happened to me, I actually asked, how come you're not descending? And they said, well, we're supposed to, you gave us that. And I said, no, it was just a speed restriction.
Well, good, that was a misunderstood clearance. Let's assume they did understand correctly and you're seeing this repetitively. I would say that more often than not, it is probably the airplane doing what it needs to do to comply with that. So at 16,000, it's like, I got nothing left. The only way I can slow down is to pitch up. So do you find that at least, what is happening more often? Are they leveling at 16?
Or
yes. All right, then that sounds like a communication adjustment needs to be made.
And Anne-Marie, just to add on to that, it would be helpful when someone's on a descend via procedure and you give them something different, but you want them to remain on the procedures, to reissue, you know, to the descend via. So they realize they're still on the procedure, but you've made one change to a particular portion of that procedure.
Okay, thank you.
Brandon?
It's Fred Nowyokes, SFO Tower. It feels like with NextGen that we've been forced to implement a lot of new phraseology at every level, en route, terminal, across the board. For instance, SFO, along with the takeoff clearance, we have to say RNAV 2 first fix if they're an RNAV departure procedure. That's a lot of extra phraseology and a lot of extra readback, and we understand it's a workload-intensive time in the cockpit, and it forces another look down in the cockpit. We have a very small window to where we can clear aircraft for takeoff. My basic question is, how do we combat this excessive phraseology in places where it really serves no purpose? We understand at LAX maybe RNAV2 phraseology works well or is necessary. At our airport it isn't, but we're being forced to say it.
And I'm not 100% sure if I'm answering your question here, but I know there are some procedures we fly where we're cleared to fly this climb via procedure RNAV-2, and that's because there's multiple points that may be on procedure initially, and we need to make sure we're turning to the right one, even though they're all on the same procedure. I'm not sure if that's what you were getting at.
So
it's a confirmation.
So at SFO, there aren't multiple. And I understand where that phraseology is necessary where there are. At SFO, there aren't. There's only one choice. And we're being forced to issue it along with the takeoff clearance, which I think is a very poor time to be using that excessive phraseology.
I'm sorry. I'd like to say from a controller's point of view, whenever you have a safety issue where you feel it is a safety issue, this phraseology is cumbersome and it's unnecessary and it's degrading the safety of the NAS, you should use ATSAP. You should use ATSAP every time, multiple times. They may not change the 0.65 phraseology for you, but there may be something that can be done specifically to help you out in your facility.
Andy, do you have something for that?
I think he left the mic already, but I believe they're operating under parallel runway departures, and that was instituted as a mitigation for blunders off of one runway to an RNAV fix that serves the other runway. So that's why it's set.
And we have time for two more questions, and then we're going to have to shut it down. Gary?
All right. Rick Wallace, Washington Center. I got a question for you. We deal a lot with the descend vias going into Charlotte. And part of it is if we assign you a Mach number for the in-trail spacing into the airport, and then we clear you to descend a via, what does that mean to you as a pilot if I have an en route speed assigned and then clear to descend via? As a pilot, what are you thinking? What are you doing up there?
Yeah, I think a lot of pilots are going to try and maintain that last speed assignment even when you give the descend via. So just simply saying descend via normal speed would trigger the pilot back into the speeds that are on the star. Changing speeds changes the calculation in the aircraft of how it's when it's going to descend, at what rate it's going to descend, in order to cope with energy management. So any time we can fly just the chartered speeds, that's easier for us. But once we get a speed assignment, we keep that speed assignment until we're given something different specifically.
And keep in mind, too, if we are assigned an en-route speed assignment and then cleared to descend via, that erases that en-route speed assignment. We're now going to fly either the last assigned speed or program descent speed or whatever is published on the procedure. If you want us to maintain that speed, you know, descend via such and such arrival, except maintain. Again, phraseology is critical. We need to understand. But if we were told, you know, maintain 210, then you say, all right, once you reach this point, you're clear to descend via, that goes out the window. So we're going to fly the published speed or whatever we programmed in or the last assigned.
You are correct in your philosophy in thinking about that. That's exactly what we're trying to relate to the pilots, but it's not getting out there. I don't know, lack of training or what, but if you are assigned a Mach number and then you clear to descend via, that speed goes out the window and then you got to comply with the published speeds. So we're having a lot of problems with that exactly because you get see up there two different answers for the one question, how they interpret it.
That's an education piece, and I guess that would be on our end in this particular.
That's what I was trying to relay is if you clarify that when you give the descent via you.
And on the other point, when the assignment, we've tried this too. We're like, okay, resume normal speed, clear to descend via. And then we've had pilots just go through it and not do the published speeds. They're like, well, you gave us normal speed. So we're having a lot of communication problems on both ends for that issue. So thank you for your time.
Yep. Again, ATSAP would be good with that. We do communicate with ATSAP a lot through the CISP program.
All right, and last question.
Do we have time for one more?
Yes.
Christina Jones, Washington Center. My question is regarding holding. I'm not sure if this has come up before. I think it might have, but we've had to adapt phraseology to say clearance limit is, as opposed to cleared to, because we don't want pilots to, one, come off the route, or two, if they are, it seems straight in to go to that fix, we don't want to delete any of the restrictions on an arrival that they still need to descend via, except still hold. So my question is, has that been dealt with? Have you heard of that? The education for the pilots with that, is that something that can be locally adapted?
That phraseology issue, from my perspective, has already been in place. If I'm on a published procedure, you want me to hold your clearance limit is, all right? You haven't said anything that's going to take me off my lateral or vertical portion of the procedure. You're just telling me where it's going to end. And at that point, I know I'm going to be holding. If you do say clear two, you just wiped out the procedure. So again, words matter.
I'm going to respectfully disagree with that.
Oh, here we go.
Clear two is a holding, is a clearance to a limit. Clear direct is a clearance to a fix.
Words matter.
All right, Andy. Thank you.
So I wanted to thank everybody for all their questions, and I wanted to thank the panel for your input and the discussion. We enjoyed it immensely. I also wanted to mention, it's been brought up a few times, about ATSAP. It seems to be a lot of communication issues. Utilize ATSAP. We do share with the airlines, the ones that partner with us. So make sure you utilize that. But thank you again, and we look forward to next year.